Coming live from Farmington High School, it's the FHS Morning Show. And now, here's your host, Summer Welch.
Hello. Welcome to the show. I'm your host, Summer Welch, and it's Arbor Day, so happy Arbor Day. I want to start off the show by congratulating the FHS girls bowling team for going to state and finishing in 13th place. Special congrats to Aaron Lenz, Ariel Langenberger, and Stevie Smedgehammer, who were named in the all-conference team. You know, I was on the bowling team when I was a freshman, and it was a lot of fun. Oh, and here we have Alpaca Facts. Go to that.
A question that's asked a lot about alpacas are, can alpacas swim? And yes, alpacas can swim, but it ruins their fleece, and that's what's important. The alpaca's fleece is actually flame resistant, and not the alpaca though, just the fleeces. So.
Thanks, Jesse. Gotta love alpaca facts. All right, so Tuesday, April 26th was Channing Tatum's birthday. He's now 36 years old.
I thought he was older.
I think he looks great for 30. I mean, 36 isn't that old, but he looks great.
He does, I mean, for like someone who's 36.
Someone's just a hater.
Okay, well, happy belated birthday. So two gamers, Carl and Renette, decided to play a virtual reality game called the Brookhaven Experiment. And it's a first-person shooter game, and they send horrific monsters like at you. And since you're wearing like those Oculus goggle things, they're like right at your face.
That's scary.
And the guy's reaction wasn't good. The girl's reaction, however, she was crying on the floor after the first wave.
I would cry too. I don't do video games. They kind of scare me. So
guys, it's better.
Girls rule. On Tuesday, Disney announced 9 new movies and sequels coming out, including Cruella de Vil, and Emma Stone is set to star for that. A Wrinkle in Time, and I'm going to say her name wrong, with Ava DuVernay, I think. Jungle Cruise, and Dwayne Johnson is going to be in that. Dumbo with director Tim Burton. Mary Poppins sequel, I'm really excited for this one. Emily Blunt is going to star. Yeah, and Maleficent 2, obviously Angelina Jolie. The Nutcracker and the Four Realms, The Jungle Book 2, which will also be the same cast, and Tinkerbell with Reese Witherspoon.
I can't wait for that.
Yeah, I know. I'm super excited.
So speaking of Disney, the character Rey, a.k.a. Daisy Ridley, posted a video of her practicing lightsaber drills on Facebook, and it was more of like a joking sort of rehearsal, so it wasn't the full thing, but her character Rey on The Force Awakens was already awesome. But this video just amplifies the enthusiasm for the next movie.
Gotcha.
It's so great.
Oh, there's going to be another movie?
Of course there's going to be another movie.
I haven't watched any of them.
Okay, we're going to binge watch this. But now back to you, Summer.
I would love to join that binge section. Whatever. You know, I would love to join you guys. Anyway, now we have a segment on prom. So go to that. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Amelia.
And I'm Caitlin, and we asked FHS some questions about prom.
Okay. Does my hair look okay?
Yeah, it looks good.
This is like a big deal.
What is your weirdest experience chaperoning a school dance? On a scale of 1 to 10, how much do you like your date's prom dress?
Oh, I have to say 10 or else I'll get beaten.
It's not really their color.
A solid 10.
What song are you most excited to hear on prom?
Oh my gosh, I'm not good at this. I don't know. What's a good song?
The Pina Colada song.
What?
The Pina Colada song.
The Pina Colada song.
Good choice.
Any Celine Dion song.
Ooh, turn down for what? What is your prom date's full name?
Benjamin Dean Baker.
Sarah Nicole Lambrick.
I honestly don't know my prom date's middle name, but I know his name is Nick Bauer.
What color prom dress do you think I should get this year?
Cobalt blue.
If you could choose any teacher to chaperone your party bus, who would it be?
Probably Miss Lund.
Which one?
My coach one.
Mr. Carriage. Miss Dimmitt.
Do you think you found the perfect prom dress, or did you just settle?
I found the perfect prom dress.
It's my aunt's.
I think I found the perfect dress.
Yeah. What's your worst school dance experience?
Having Cypher as my date for the 8th grade formal.
We were dating. I got her flowers. It was great.
I broke up with my girlfriend on prom before we even went to the dance, and I brought her home.
Homecoming last year.
What happened?
The music was terrible.
What are your intentions with my daughter?
I'll have her back by 12.
Nice.
Maybe. Why do you always put the mic like right against your mouth? I don't see that on TV. You're like, bam! It's like, put it here, Amelia. We can still hear you.
I'll put it right here. What color would I look best in?
Dress?
Yeah.
Green.
Have a safe prom, guys. Back to the desk.
Welcome to 192.1 The Roar. I'm your host, RJ Beal.
I'm Frankie Kohorst.
Mr. Mathis, shut the door.
Along with me, I've got
Kyle Wells,
Frankie Kohorst,
Bryce Tamble,
and Brandon Nett.
And our special guest for this week, we have the FHS Boys golf coach, Mr. Holmes.
Hey guys, how's it going?
How are you?
Good.
So we heard recently you went to the Masters. So wondering, who'd you go with and what was that like?
I did. I went down there with my good friend, best friend actually in the world, Sammy Schmitz. We went down over spring break.
All right.
And kind of just relaxed and got a feel for what the course was going to set up like for the week. He went out and played a bunch of practice rounds. Got to hang with a bunch of like one percenters, so I got to be kind of rich for the week. And then the next week the tournament started, so I stayed with him and his family down there as well. So it was surreal, man. It was great.
That's pretty cool.
Very cool. Yeah, very awesome. Cool. How long have you known Sammy?
I've known him since I've been about 2 years and 4 months. So we hung out, skated on the ponds together, played a lot of hockey, played a lot of golf growing up, and his youngest daughter is my goddaughter, so we're pretty close still.
Cool. How have you seen his play evolve over the years and to get to the point where he's at right now?
He went from, in high school, kind of just, you know, relying a lot on natural ability. Came out to courses and didn't really prepare much, but had a ton of raw talent. And then he made his way through college and was a four-time All-American at St. John's. Gave a shot at the pro tour there for about a year and a half, 2 years. The lifestyle didn't really pan out for him, and so he came back and just kind of lived the normal man's life. He's got a regular middle-class job. And in the last couple years, though, he just made a decision that he wanted to get after golf again. And this last, since January, I've never seen him hit the ball as well as he hit it. I mean, it was tour strike capability. He held his own. He went toe-to-toe with those guys, so it was perfect.
Very cool.
Yeah.
So what's coaching high school golf like?
Coaching high school golf, it's like being the navigator in an Air Force jet where you're relying on someone else to fly, and I got the map, and I got to kind of look at where can we maybe go and how can we do things, and I can put advice into kids' ears, but really it's in the pilot's hands. They're out there and they're playing. And so we can set up a good plan, but with golf, a lot of it is mental. You know, you're playing hockey, you're playing basketball, it's reactionary. It's all physical ability in the moment. Golf, you've got to have a mindset that if you hit one bad shot, you got to let that loose, because if you don't, you're going to have a long, long round, and it's tough.
So what are your expectations for this year?
For the season, I would really like to see us move up in the South Suburban. We finished seventh last year in the South Suburban. We had our first South Suburban invite this year, and we started off in fifth. We have four more left, so I'd like to see us kind of creep to fourth, maybe get into the third place if possible. But mainly it's not necessarily about setting goals of how you want to finish in the conference or where you want kids to end up. It's more about them realizing how golf relates to life and how they can become better people, better community members, and use that to their advantage in the business world later on.
And then how long have you been into golf and coaching?
I started coaching as an assistant coach back in 2004. And then Jerry Grubner, who was the head coach, left in 2007, and I took over that next season, so it's been about 7-8 years now.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right. Cool. So just really quick questions out of curiosity. What's like one thing while golfing that's like absolutely embarrassed you, or something you just got so frustrated at?
Like personally?
Personally, yeah.
I think the very first state am I ever played in, there was this, there was the first hole, and there's probably, you know, I don't know, maybe 100 people around the tee boxes, all the guys that are getting ready to tee off. And I go to set up, and I put the tee down, and the ball's kind of sitting on the tee, and I go to hit, and then I realized that I had set the ball about 5 inches in front of the tee markers, which is a penalty. And so I looked at it, and I realized that I'm sitting there in front of 100 people that are all great golfers, and I just made the biggest mistake of my life, and I had to re-tee and take the two-stroke penalty, and that was super embarrassing because I'm a coach. I've played a long time. It was like, oh, come on, man.
That's great.
Yeah.
All right, so that's all we have for today, guys. Next up, we have Mr. Berg and Mr. Pickens for Spitfire, so let's take a look at that.
Hey, guys, welcome to another episode of Spitfire. Today we have
Mr. Berg
and
Mr. Pickens.
So you guys know the rules. We'll time how fast you answer questions. You guys ready?
You bet. Let's do it.
All right, go. Favorite animal?
Otter.
How many fingers do you have?
7.
Biking or skiing?
Skiing.
Summer or winter?
Summer.
Indoors or outdoors?
Indoors.
Alpacas or llamas?
Alpaca.
Lowest number you can think of?
-8.
Baseball or football?
Football.
MOA or Burnsville Mall?
MOA.
What's the name of our show this try?
Spitfire.
Vikings or Packers?
Vikings.
What's a perfect day to you?
Wednesday.
Favorite state?
Minnesota.
Favorite person?
Mr. Berg.
How much do you spend combing your hair?
0.
Thanks, guys. Now back to you guys at the desk.
Space. Very few will have the opportunity to travel to this location, but one lucky Farmington teacher will get to experience what no one in this area has had the chance to experience. And now, direct from Boeckman Middle School, please welcome Mr. Todd Kohorst.
Thank you so much for being here. So you're going to space. So why are you doing that?
I'm part of what's called Project POSSUM. POSSUM is an acronym for Polar Suborbital Science in the Upper Mesosphere. Trying to study noctilucent clouds, space clouds they're called, the highest clouds in the atmosphere. They're just not well understood. They're too high for ground radar to study them, too low for satellites in orbit to study them. And we're planning and training to fly on these new suborbital spacecraft to go up and collect data on this part of the atmosphere. I think it's also linked to climate change. These clouds have been around more recently, and they're thicker at a greater extent in their range, and we think that's because our climate's getting warmer, but just not well understood, not known right now.
So what exactly are you doing up there?
We'll be collecting data using this Lynx Mark II spacecraft, and actually there's a slide of it in there showing the flight profile of it. So basically this spacecraft takes off horizontally like an airplane, pitches up 85 degrees, and then you go full thrust, going Mach 3, about 2,000 miles an hour at that point. And in 3 minutes, you use up all the fuel. Yep, there's the slide of how this works. So you're going Mach 3, burn up all the fuel, 5,000 pounds of fuel. And at that point, you're still coasting upwards, though. They cut the engine, but there's still enough energy to keep coasting upwards. So keep going up and up and up, and as you're going up, you're collecting data. We've got a camera system to zoom in on these noctilucent cloud features. We've got a probe that we deploy after we get through air, which that's kind of cool and kind of shows in the picture there. After you get through air, the sky's black again. You see the stars because you're above the atmosphere.
Yeah.
And you deploy a probe that can't be out in the air, it'd rip off, and you reach the top, you're weightless for a while. After they cut the engines, you're weightless, you start coming back down, you collect another sample of the clouds, you're collecting data, looking at particle size and density, and just trying to figure out what's going on in this area of the atmosphere.
Yeah.
All right, and then I have one quick question for you. I know it's a quick trip, but are you bringing any astronaut food?
No plans for any astronaut food. The whole flight's only a half hour. It's about 5 minutes going up to the top, about 5 minutes down to catch until you start hitting air again, it gets louder, and then you pull out, and then you just coast back, and then you kind of get to relax. But that first 10 minutes is the real intense part, deploying the probes, collecting the pictures of the clouds. So no food, unfortunately.
No food? Not even a snack?
I don't think so.
No astronaut food?
No, not for this.
That's a bummer. Oh, well, it'll be fun anyway.
Yeah, definitely.
So how much preparation have you done to get ready?
So far, I've done a 4-day training down in Florida at Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University. The first day, a lot of academics learning about everything that's going on. My scientist astronaut manual here, I need to basically know front to back. And then I did the hypoxia chamber, which is that picture right there, where you're in this chamber and they're slowly cutting your oxygen, simulating going up in altitude. And as they're cutting your oxygen, you're flying a flight simulator and they're giving you instructions like pitch down, turn to the right, keep a steady heading, keep going at this altitude. And you're losing mental capacity. You're starting to, it's getting tough. You're like, I was breathing really heavy and it gets tough to do. And the point of that training was to just see what your symptoms are as you're becoming hypoxic. And that would be in case the plane would depressurize. Next day, did spacesuit training, which is right there. That's me and Nikolai Moseyev. He's probably the top Russian, or top spacesuit designer in the world. He's from Russia and works for Final Frontier Designs. I got to put on the spacesuit, and I might be the biggest person to ever be in a spacesuit. They were worried I wasn't gonna fit in there. I was over max on chest size, but I got in. And got to do the flight simulator in the spacesuit. So simulating the whole mission that we're planning to do while wearing the spacesuit, and that was very cool. Then I got to do this aerobatic flight, which that's me in the plane flying upside down. So we did barrel rolls. We got up to 5 G's of force. Like if you take your weight times 5, that's what that felt like. Then we flew upside down and curled up, which gives you -2 G's. It basically feels like your stomach's coming out of the top of your head. Oh. And that was kind of the intense part. Afterwards, it was exhausting. It was cool. I thought it was a blast the whole time. It was fun, but it was exhausting. You're just tired afterwards. Then more recently, in February, I went out to Philadelphia and did the centrifuge training at the NASTAR Center. They were offering it for free right now because they're trying to collect data on a bunch of people and see how they do on these suborbital flights. And that's where they spin you around real fast and see how you do. I didn't have any negative effects. There's a few people that got close to passing out and maybe feeling sick. And that's a picture of the outside of it. That thing's about 40 feet long. And yeah, it was pretty cool. They simulated the suborbital flight that I'm hoping to fly on someday, and now I'm pretty confident that I can withstand the G-forces associated with that. It's pretty intense. You're very tired and exhausted afterwards. You have to do what's called anti-G straining maneuvers, like tense up all the muscles in the lower part of your body to keep the blood up at your brain so that the blood doesn't pull down and you pass out or anything like that. So it was pretty intense, but I thought it was a blast. It was a great time. I'm really looking forward to hopefully doing this flight someday.
So you're not scared at all, or no?
No, I wouldn't say scared. I mean, there's always, you want to make sure that you're well prepared, and I feel like I've been doing quite a bit to prepare, but I wouldn't say scared, just excited.
Yeah, excited. It sounds really exciting. So has it always been like a dream for you to go into space?
Yeah, I've always thought space is awesome. I've always been interested in science, and once I started hearing about these suborbital spacecraft being made, I thought maybe someday I could fly in those when I'm old enough and maybe have enough money and the price would come down. But I saw this pop up on nationalgeographic.com one day and clicked on it. I was like, wow, this is awesome. I should do that. And I applied to it. I spent like a whole day filling out my application, doing the best I could on that, and found out last July I actually got accepted and been moving forward with it ever since. So it's been, yeah, definitely a dream come true.
One of my last questions is, how heavy is all the equipment that you wear?
The spacesuit is relatively light compared to old ones. I think it's about 23 pounds with the whole thing. So not that heavy, actually. And Final Frontier Design is the company that's making this. And they've been working hard to keep it as light as possible. But it gets pretty warm in there, but it's pretty cool that you can see the hoses coming out by my arm there. And they've got a cooling system, which is a pretty low-tech cooling system. It's basically you just run those hoses through a cooler full of ice water, and then it blows on you. There's a fan that blows it, and it feels really good, though. It works.
Yeah, so is there anything else you want to add?
The big thing, exciting thing coming to Farmington that I'll be running this summer is what's called Possum Academy. So basically it's going to be the same thing that I did down in Florida, but offered now for high school and undergraduate college students. So you have to be at least 16 years old, but anyone here I'm really hoping will apply to this. If you're interested in science, in climate change, in space, and you want to wear a spacesuit, you should do Possum Academy. For Possum Academy, we're going to be bringing in spacesuits, the same spacesuits that I had. We're going to be bringing in a flight simulator, the same flight simulator that I trained on, and it's going to be at Boeckman Middle School. I've got a room already laid out that's going to have that simulator in it, and you'll get to wear a spacesuit, and you'll get to have pictures like I have there of yourself in a spacesuit in the simulator. So that's the awesome stuff that we're bringing in, and then as well as technicians to run that stuff. I'll be teaching the science courses that go with this, learning about the atmosphere and noctilucent clouds, these space clouds that we're trying to study. And I highly encourage anyone from here to apply. The plan is, if we get enough Farmington students to apply, the whole first week is going to be just Farmington students, which is 24 students each week, and that'll be August 1st through 5th. And then the second week would be anybody else from the rest of the state or Midwest or kind of anybody else interested. And it is pretty expensive right now. I wish it was less. I got the cost on some. I got a few $1,000 from area businesses. It used to be closer to $2,000. Got it down to $1,750 for 4 days for doing all of that. And then there's the option of the aerobatic flight and learning about spaceflight physiology for an extra $650 for an extra day. And they'll be doing the whole mission simulation, all the academics, same thing that I did down in Florida. So awesome opportunity. This is the only one happening outside of Florida in the entire United States. So it's been pretty awesome that we're able to bring this to Farmington.
Yeah, definitely. I would definitely recommend anyone to sign up for it if they really want to. And thank you guys. Thank you for so much for coming, because it was really awesome getting to hear all that and getting to spread the opportunity for everyone who wants to do that. But now we have sports with Jesse.
Hi everyone, I'm Jesse, and I'm actually here with my brother, TJ, and we're here to talk about crashed ice. So for the people that don't know, what is crashed ice?
So crashed ice, the actual sport, is called ice cross downhill, and it's essentially a head-to-head race down an ice track with several obstacles and hairpin turns down the way, and you try to make it down the track as fast as you can.
All right. How do you prepare for every race that you do?
Preparing for every race, we try to keep it the same every day. Your morning routine stays the same. You get up in the morning, you work out a little bit, get the blood flowing, get a solid breakfast in, and then the rest of the day before the race is kind of time to just go over your game plan and make sure you have the right idea going down the track.
Yeah, for sure. So when you get up to the opening gate, what goes through your mind right before you go down?
The opening gate when you get up there is pretty intense, but as soon as you hear riders ready, 5 second warning, everything kind of goes blank, and it's about staying on your feet and going down that track as fast as you can.
Focus up. So how do you train during the off season?
Training is probably the hardest part of the sport. There's really no essential ice track that we can train on. So a lot of it is strength training in the gym, plyos, rollerblading, playing hockey, getting on the ice when we can.
Oh yeah. So where have you traveled this season and in the past seasons?
This season we started out in Quebec, and then I traveled to Austria. I was in a week in Helsinki. We came back for 2 more races in Canada, and then we finished up the season here in St. Paul.
All over the place.
All over the place.
So, like, there's a lot of injuries that happen during this crashed ice. But what is your worst injury?
So my worst injury actually didn't happen during a crashed ice race. I was actually training for it this past summer on some rollerblades, and I broke my thumb. I ended up having to put a pin down the middle, and I still don't have all the movement to it yet. So.
All right, well, what are your other hobbies or jobs that you do besides crashed ice?
Right now, I currently work with CCM Hockey, but for some other hobbies, I mean, I play golf all the time, play hockey, rollerblade. It's about anything to stay active.
Very active. So what kind of like equipment do you have to use for the crashed ice?
So for me personally, I wear all hockey gear. Some of the other guys pictured, you have motorcycle helmets, a little bit of lacrosse gloves, some football gloves. But generally, as long as you're fully protected head to toe, you can make it down the track in one piece.
All right, well, thank you very much, TJ.
Thank you for having me.
Yep. Back to you at the desk, Summer.
Thank you. All right, so the robotics team is in the World Championships right now, and it's in St. Louis, and they are competing against 600 different teams from around the world, and I am so proud of them, and it sounds like a lot of fun. So it's... oh, now we have an alpaca fact. Let's go to that.
Another alpaca question that people have are, can an alpaca mate with a llama? I don't recommend it, but yes, it is possible. It has to be a male alpaca and a female llama, and it's called a horizo. Now you know. The alpaca's fiber can come in 16 different tones. I've only had a brown one and a white one, because the black one, he died. Alpacas are often known to be messy and stuff, but they're actually very clean and they are even potty trained. Yep, you just need to move the feces wherever you want them to go to the bathroom at, and they'll go pee and poop there. Now you know. There you have it, folks. That's it from Alpaca Facts.
All right, thanks. The blood drive is on May 6th, and today is the last day to sign up for it. You must have certain requirements like weight and other things, and you must be 16 or older and must have a permission slip if you are 16. Haley, are you going to be doing the blood drive?
Yeah, no, I can't. I'm 17. I could totally do it, but I am so afraid of needles. Mm-hmm. I can't do blood. I can't do needles. I'd most likely pass out. So are you going to do the blood drive at all?
No, I have an AP test that day, and I don't want to affect me in any way, you know,
yeah,
just in case, I want to pass. So you have another announcement?
I do. I have an announcement about Cabaret. If you guys aren't doing anything tomorrow, you should totally come. So there's a show at 3, which I will be in with my friend Taylor Moley. We're going to be awesome, so you should come to that one. There's also one at 7 if you can't make it to 3. It's $10 for adults, $7 for students, and we'll have some food and all that stuff. And we actually have a little preview for you so you can see what's going to be at Cabaret.
Attention, no pension to more than one dimension. Starving for attention, hating convention, hating
the teacher.
Not to mention, of course, hating mom and dad.
All right, that was a great preview. Now I'm on the couch here with Mr. Williams, and he went to D.C. over spring break. What was your travels?
Absolutely. We had an absolutely wonderful time heading to Washington, D.C. For 2 days and then 3 days out to New York City. So various sites that we got to see, but the weather, let me go on and piggyback on that. The weather was absolutely beautiful when we first got there. Wouldn't you agree with that, Percy?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, so as you can see on the monitor, that was the Martin Luther King Memorial, and that particular slab was when we went into the front of the White House. You know, it looks like just us there, but there were literally, I say, hundreds of people there. The memorial that you see there is the Iwo Jima in the Marines Barracks in Washington, D.C. Again, another day. And then, of course, that last one that you see there is the Metropolitan Museum of Art. But it was an absolutely wonderful event. You know, most of us learned a lot of things. You know, looking at the sites and being a part of, you know, of our society, the things that we read about in history books, we were actually living. So, you know.
Yeah. So, did you have any troubles with like the airport or anything like that with your travels?
You know, I think most of the groups did at some point. Mm-hmm. We did have a major snafu. That snafu was we missed that flight. Due to mechanical problems. And what that did was take a day off our Washington, D.C. tour, which the company gave us another day in New York to make up for that. So we got to spend another day in New York, but we also gave up a day in Washington, D.C.
Oh, yeah, that's, you know, that's not fun. But what was your favorite thing to see while you're down over there? Yeah.
For me, it was a couple of things, but the major thing was the Martin Luther King Memorial. That was one of the things that was on my bucket list sort of thing. What about you, Percy?
It was in New York. I like the 9/11 Memorial. Mm-hmm. Like going inside, they had the fire truck and all that. That was still there. That was in videos you seen.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it had like the wall up too, like the wall, like some of the walls that were still in the memorial during the crash.
Yeah, and it was probably one of the most gut-wrenching emotional pieces that we could have, you know, seen because of, you know, what went on in that particular location. And it was almost like an eerie quiet, but a polite quiet for people to kind of, you know, pay their respect to the people that was, you know, killed there.
Mm-hmm. Well, is there anything else you would like to add?
You know, I'm just looking forward to our next trip, you know, whether it's, you know, in the D.C. or New York area. So I think Philadelphia may be another piece of that that we may want to add to that, and as well as Williamsburg, Virginia, maybe Boston. It's just fantastic that we can go in and do that, you know, that we could have a trip that's, you know, stationary for young people to go in and be a part of here in the United States. versus going abroad, you know.
What you think? Do you think it's a place that would you like to go? What would you like to come
like
to mind?
Anywhere. Anywhere else. Anywhere.
I guess he's an Acapulco.
Yeah. You know. All right, well, thank you so much for coming. I think we have a short commercial break, am I right? Or no, never mind. We're ending the show, I guess. I have one more quick announcement. Seniors, you may pick up your baby pictures from Miss Chewinka. And thank you so much for watching. Thanks to our guests. And Haley, get your propaganda out of there. Speaking of that, please vote for prom court juniors and seniors because we don't have much time left. Haley, get out of there. She just wants you to vote for her date. Thank you. We'll see you next time. And here's Jazz Band.